it seem like we pay attention to what is in the air now more than ever? I am definitely concerned about what the air is like inside more than I did in the past. How many windows are open? What's the ventilation like? Where's that smell coming from? Okay, maybe that's just my house. It's definitely true that indoor air quality is a bigger concern now than ever before. And one of the key components of air quality is the amount of carbon dioxide present. Maybe you already knew that. But maybe you didn't know that there are some new innovative ways to measure carbon dioxide levels. Oh yes, there are. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. The amount of CO2 in the air can be a key indicator in indoor air quality. And improving our indoor air quality can have a whole lot of benefits, including increased energy efficiency, increased cognitive performance, and even the reduction of the risk for viral infection. In today's Chalk Talk, Bernd Zimmermann joins me to discuss this very issue. We chat about the reasons behind measuring CO2 in our indoor spaces, what this kind of measurement looks like, and why Sensirion's new SD4 CO2 sensors are breaking new ground in this carbon dioxide measurement arena. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about this topic from Sensirion. Hi, Bernd. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hello, and thank you, Amelia, for the introduction. I would like to start the presentation by taking a step back and sharing some interesting statistics about indoor air quality. First, it is important to know that there's actually 2 to 5 times more pollution found indoors than outdoors. The reason for this is that outdoor pollutants are much more diluted than indoor pollutants because of the higher air volume present outdoors. Or you can think of it as a mathematical equation. Air pollution is equal to the amount of pollutants divided by air volume. The denominator in this equation is much higher in outdoor spaces than indoor spaces. Also, indoors, air circulates in a confined space, and the pollutants generated by humans or emitted by common household materials such as cleaning supplies, new furniture, and carpeting accumulate over time. So, combined with the fact that people spend 90% of their time indoors, and even more so now with the COVID pandemic, indoor air quality is one of the top environmental risks to public health.
Okay, so before we dig into the details, can we talk a little bit about why CO2 levels are important?
Sure. Carbon dioxide in particular is a key parameter which contributes to indoor air quality. Being able to measure CO2 and then taking appropriate corrective action to lower its levels when they are too high is extremely important for your health and general well-being. Humans exhale carbon dioxide as part of our metabolism, which then accumulates in the surrounding environment over time. This accumulation is especially pronounced if there are multiple people in confined spaces such as meeting or living rooms, offices, auditoriums, etc. So high CO2 concentration levels have very adverse effects on humans. It reduces our cognitive performance, can cause health issues, and compromise our well-being. The CO2 concentration range in typical indoor environments can range anywhere from 400 ppm to well over 2000 ppm, as shown at the bottom of this slide. 400 ppm represents the atmospheric background concentration. This is what you experience when you go outdoors and is normal, healthy level of CO2. At a concentration of 1000 ppm, people start feeling drowsy. As a result, they become less productive, which of course is detrimental for work. A CO2 concentration of 2000 ppm is what we may experience after prolonged time in meeting rooms. Such high CO2 concentrations can also result in people getting headaches. Therefore, ventilation of indoor spaces is key for human health, both at home and at work.
That makes sense.
Next, let's dive into the reasons why we should measure CO2 in indoor spaces. First is energy efficiency. Building operation is responsible for roughly 1/4 of worldwide CO2 emissions. And a large fraction of the produced emissions come from inefficient HVAC systems. One way to guarantee Low CO2 levels and a healthy exchange of air coming in and out of your indoor spaces is by keeping ventilation turned on all the time. This is what many building operators do. Obviously, this is not a very energy efficient approach and results in excessive CO2 emissions. So how could we still make sure that we're getting good exchange of air while indoors, but only when we need it? Well, CO2 monitors that are connected to HVAC systems can turn on ventilation based on the levels of CO2 in a room. If a room is empty, the low CO2 level indicates that no ventilation is necessary in that specific room, thereby saving energy. If a room has been filled with people for a while, the high CO2 concentration alerts the HVAC system to ventilate at a higher level in that specific room. This kind of CO2 regulated HVAC system is called demand control ventilation, or DCV. Another reason why we want to measure CO2 levels is productivity. As briefly touched upon earlier, high CO2 levels can negatively affect productivity and can result in sleepiness, headaches, and other negative symptoms. Employers, of course, want to maximize the productivity of their employees, which is why more and more companies are looking to monitor CO2 at the workplace. Here on this graph, taken from a study published in Environmental Health Perspectives, you can see the direct correlation between CO2 levels and performance levels on key functions required at the workplace.
All right, Bern. So you mentioned that well-being was also a reason to measure CO2. Can you explain that a bit more?
Yes, absolutely. Not only at the workplace, but in general, we want to measure CO2 concentration because prolonged exposure to high CO2 level affects our well-being. As shown in this slide, most people are satisfied when indoor CO2 levels are below 1,000 ppm.
Now, mitigating viral infection is more important than ever before. And you mentioned that this is also a reason to measure CO2 as well. Can you explain that a bit more?
As mentioned briefly before, CO2 has a direct correlation to viral transmission, a key topic in today's environment. And as you know, all humans exhale CO2 when you breathe. Viruses and bacteria are emitted from infected humans as they exhale, cough, or sneeze. Therefore, airborne infectious aerosols accumulate along with CO2 in indoor environments that have poor air exchange, and CO2 levels can then be correlated to virus and bacteria concentrations in the air.
So, Bern, we all know that COVID-19 is transmitted in the air. Can you address how this comes into play as well?
Yes. There have been many studies on this subject, but I would like to highlight in particular an article in the journal Oxford Academics, which states that it is crucial for us to address the problem of airborne COVID-19 transmission. The most effective way to address this type of virus transmission is to ensure proper ventilation of heavily used indoor spaces. If you ventilate these spaces frequently, you can quickly remove and replace contaminated aerosols with fresh air. A CO2 monitor as a proxy for potentially contaminated aerosols can help notify people to ventilate rooms as necessary.
Okay, so now that we have talked about why we want to measure and understand CO2 levels, can we talk about how we should go about doing that?
Yes, let's look at the various ways to achieve this in our daily lives. Demand-controlled ventilation systems are one way to monitor and control CO2 levels. An added benefit of having demand control ventilation system is energy savings, as we discussed previously. In the workplace, in particular, state-of-the-art HVAC systems are key as it can be extremely expensive to have sick employees staying at home instead of working. Another way to monitor CO2 levels is by using indoor air quality monitors. Indoor air quality monitors that can measure CO2 are becoming more and more popular as people become more aware of how CO2 concentration correlates to levels of viruses in the air, such as COVID-19. Even more advanced indoor air quality monitors can integrate with a ventilation alarm that can remind you to take smart actions to keep infection risk low. Another solution is to use so-called CO2 traffic light indicators. These are simply monitors equipped with green, yellow, and red indicators to show when CO2 levels are good, medium, or bad. These devices are very easy to use and understand, and many schools worldwide are using them in their classrooms to improve chances of reopening schools for our students. In addition to CO2 traffic light indicators and IAQ monitors, smart home alarm systems can alert people when CO2 concentrations reach a critical level and can prompt users to open a window, for example. Lastly, many standalone air purifier systems are starting to include CO2 level monitoring, simply as another IAQ parameter to be displayed, even though these devices currently cannot automatically regulate CO2 levels. In the future, these devices may be able to communicate with the HVAC system to provide closed-loop ventilation based on CO2 levels.
Okay, so Bernd, can we get into how I can measure CO2?
Well, Amelia, all of the systems discussed previously would require some type of CO2 sensor. Let's take a look at the available CO2 sensors on the market today. The vast majority of traditional CO2 sensors are based on non-dispersive infrared technology, also referred to as NDIR technology. NDIR sensors are gas selective and can be very accurate. However, the technology also comes with some inherent drawbacks. First, the device sensitivity is proportional to the optical absorption path lengths, therefore minimizing the sensor and thereby reducing the optical path lengths compromises sensor performance. This is the main reason why there's still no truly miniaturized NDIR sensor on the market. Secondly, the bill of materials of NDIR sensors is not very cost-effective. Because of the many additional discrete components required to achieve its function, this also limits how much these devices can be miniaturized. And lastly, NDIR sensors are sensitive to mechanical and thermal stress, which can result in loss of performance because of the very small deformations of the optical sensing cavity. Therefore, these sensors must be assembled via through-hole soldering to avoid loss of performance. Compared to surface mount assembly, this process, of course, can be expensive and inefficient. As a result, Sensirion began looking for ways to address the pitfalls of these traditional NDIR sensors. We first laid the groundwork by producing our own NDIR sensor, which we launched 3 years ago. It is and was then called the SCD-30. Why didn't we start with the SCD-30? Well, our motto is that before breaking the rules, you must first master them. While the SCD-30 set a new standard for NDIR sensors at the time, it did not necessarily disrupt the market.
Okay, so can we dig into some of the details of your new CO2 sensor? How does it address the size and cost issues you mentioned earlier?
Yes, let's dig into these details. Sensirion developed a miniaturized version, the SCD-4X, with a mission statement to break the size and cost barriers for CO2 sensors. We observed that many customers were willing to integrate a CO2 sensor into their application, but did not do so because existing CO2 sensors were too expensive and physically too big. So, how was Sensirion able to realize such miniaturization without compromising sensor performance? Well, we applied different sensing technology called photoacoustic sensing. With our expertise in miniaturizing sensors, we took this traditionally big and bulky technology used for lab equipment and condensed its size by several orders of magnitude.
Okay, so how exactly does this photoacoustic technology work?
This slide shows the internal components of the SCD-4X. A small IR emitter generates optical signals which collide with the CO2 molecules. Some of the kinetic energy is converted into acoustic energy upon impact with the CO2 molecules. This acoustic energy can then be detected by a small, ultra-sensitive microphone and further processed to convert the acoustic response to corresponding CO2 concentration. This is shown on the left of the slide.
Okay, so how does your photoacoustic technology compare with the traditional NDIR?
Let's take a closer look at how the two compare. In contrast to NDIR sensors, the sensitivity of photoacoustic technology is not dependent on the size of the sensing cavity. Therefore, photoacoustic sensors can be miniaturized without compromising sensor performance. Bill of material considerations are also important. The SCD-4X uses less components compared to traditional NDIR sensors, which makes it highly cost-effective. Finally, let me address robustness. Photoacoustic sensors are much more robust, therefore more capable of withstanding mechanical and thermal stress. They can be reflow soldered, making the assembly process much more efficient.
Okay, so overall, What does your solution buy me as an engineer? What are the real benefits we're looking at here?
Sure. Let's review the main benefits of the new SCD4X CO2 sensor. The most innovative aspect of this sensor is obviously its size, which allows for significantly more flexibility in designing in the component. The SCD4X fits into a three-dimensional space of only 1 cubic centimeter. The picture here shows the relative size of the SCD4X compared to Sensirion's NDIR-based CO2 sensor. In quantitative terms, this is one order of magnitude smaller than any other CO2 sensors currently on the market. Another important benefit is that the SCD4X is surface mount solderable. This allows very cost-efficient, high-volume production and avoids human error induced during the assembly process. And of course, the SCD4X provides excellent sensing performance with a wide measurement range for CO2 concentration, good accuracy, high CO2 selectivity, and on-chip humidity and temperature compensation.
Now, I would imagine that robustness would be important here as well. How does your solution stack up in this arena?
Yes, exactly. As briefly mentioned earlier, the SCD4X features a very robust technology that withstands thermal and mechanical stress. Also, the SCD4X can withstand water droplets and dust, capability provided by an integrated filter membrane. Lastly, I'd like to point out the versatility of the SCD4X. What do we mean by this? Sensirion has a smart implementation which allows us to operate the sensor at low energy consumption over a wide voltage range. This is a huge advantage as you don't need to build in external circuitry, so it saves costs to the customer. It also features adjustable power consumption, so there are different operating modes. Plus, it includes a pre-calibrated relative humidity and temperature output signal. Our colleagues in Switzerland like to relate the versatility of the SCD40 to the versatility of a Swiss Army knife.
Very cool. Okay, so we have the SCD40 and the SCD41. Bernd, can you explain a bit about the differences between these two products?
Yes, sure. We currently offer two variants, the SCD40 and, as you said, the SCD41. The SCD40 is the lower cost variant. It provides what most users require in indoor air quality applications. The SCD41 has slightly better accuracy and a wider output range. It is specifically targeted for the European HVAC market and allows operation in single shot operating mode for lower power applications.
Okay, so what if I'm interested in improving my air quality? What other options would I have?
In addition to monitoring CO2, Sensirion offers some other products in our portfolio, including relative humidity and temperature sensors, formaldehyde sensors, particulate matter sensors, and volatile organic compound sensors. These products round out our environmental sensor platform.
So this has been a lot to take in. Bernd, can you recap your main points for me?
Sure. In summary, CO2 concentration is key to measuring indoor air quality, not only to maximize human health and work performance, but also to reduce the risk of viral infection in indoor air spaces. Traditional NDIR sensors have been too bulky, expensive, and difficult to assemble, and have therefore limited their application. Sensirion has recently overcome the size and cost barriers with a new CO2 sensor using groundbreaking photoacoustic technology.
All right. Well, if my audience wants more information, where should they go?
If you would like to see further information on our CO2 sensors and read up about indoor air quality, please check out these three links. Thank you very much for your time and attention.
Thank you so much for joining me, Bernd. And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about this topic from Sensirion. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, head on over to the Chalk Talks section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or head on over to YouTube, youtube.com/EEJournal.